It's time for the Soteriology 101 podcast, where God is most glorified by his love and provision for all people. Welcome your host, the Director of Apologetics for Texas Baptists, an adjunct professor of theology, and a local teaching pastor, Dr. Leighton Flowers.
And welcome back to Soteriology 101. Today we're going to get a quick overview of the doctrine of the nature of man. There's a lot of confusion on this particular issue, and I want to go over it in a real simple, easy to understand manner. First of all, we know that Adam and Eve were created by God as in his image, and therefore having the ability to reason, to think, to make choices. They weren't perfect. They were mutable. Mutable meaning able to fall. In other words, they were able to make choices. Most mainstream confessions of faith acknowledge that Adam and Eve were created with the liberty of the will, the ability to choose one way or another, the ability to sin or to refrain from sinning. So they're not perfect in that they're like God, because obviously God cannot sin. He's a perfect being. And so Adam and Eve aren't perfect, but they were innocent. And therefore, they were able to sin. And therefore, when the law came, when they were given a rule, do not eat of this fruit, they were given the freedom of the will. They were given the ability to make choices. And of course, we know the consequences. We know what happened. They sinned. And that's where the fall enters in. And therefore, the fall has consequences with it. But we have to acknowledge first and foremost that God did create humanity with a free will. Some would call this a libertarian free will, because it's the ability to refrain or not refrain from a given moral action. Now, some people get this confused because they'll say things like, well, God knew that Adam and Eve would fall, and therefore he must have determined for them to fall. That's a modal fallacy. It's a logical fallacy. It's confusing and conflating the concept of necessity with certainty. Something can be certainly known without being caused or determined by the knower. God, in his eternal knowledge, can know the free choices of man without necessarily determining them. So something can be certain and known without necessarily being determined by that person who knows it for certain. So if you hear some people try to argue that because God certainly knew something prior to its happening, therefore he must have determined it or wanted it or in any way desired it, they're just creating a modal fallacy. It's a philosophical issue, and they've just gone beyond the pages of Scripture into, you know, mere guessing, a philosophy of their own finite imaginations. So keep that in mind. Let's look at what the confessions within the Southern Baptist, at least, my particular denomination, the Baptist Faith and Message says this: man, in the special creation of God, made in his own image, he created them male and female as the crowning work of his creation. The gift of gender is thus part of the goodness of God's creation. In the beginning, man was innocent of his sin and was endowed by his Creator with the freedom of choice. That's what we would refer to as libertarian free will, the ability to refrain or not refrain from a given moral action. Adam and Eve were created with that ability, okay? So by his free choice, man sinned against God and brought sin into the human race. I'm not going to go through all these passages, but I encourage you to, if you want to study this more deeply, check the passages to make sure they actually align with what the confession says. So look at the fallen nature of humanity. One, they are under sin, the curse of sin. Almost like if a baby was born addicted to a drug, like some people call certain babies a crack baby, because they were born addicted to crack cocaine because their mother was an addict. That's kind of like what the Bible describes as the curse of sin. It's this weight of sin that you were born in that condition. We're born in the environment and with the tendency and the inclination towards sinfulness. Not of any fault of our own individually, because obviously when a baby's born, he didn't have anything to do with being under the curse of sin. He didn't have anything to do with being addicted to that drug, for example. And the same is true of humanity. We're born in a condition that we have no control over, but that's the fall. That's the result of the fall. It brought down the entire human race under this addiction, under this curse. And therefore, all mankind is born in this lost condition, and we all need a Savior. This person, however, has not necessarily lost the liberty of his will. In other words, that image that he was created in with Adam and Eve was created with the Imago Dei, with the image of God, able to reason and to think. They're morally able to see, hear, understand, and repent, even in light of God's revelation. So what we believe is that mankind, though sinful, though fallen, though need of a Savior, they still have the moral capacity to respond to God. This is why we believe Jesus, in speaking in a sermon, he pulls up a child and says, you must become humble like this child in order to enter the kingdom of heaven. Well, what's the difference between a child and an adult? Well, a child is not yet grown hardened and calloused in his sinfulness. He's humble. He's able to be molded. He's willing to listen. He's willing to learn. And that's the nature of a child. And so a child who has not grown hardened, or someone who has not grown callous to the revelation of God, they are morally able to hear, to see, to understand, and to turn to God so as to be reconciled from the curse of sin, so as to be saved. But mankind is still sinful. They're still under the curse. They've just not lost that natural ability of the will that God endowed with all of humanity from birth, that from very act of creation. In fact, what we see in Genesis is that when sin entered the world, God didn't say the curse was to not only you would labor the toil and that you would have labor pains, and also you would lose the capacity to respond willingly to me from now on. It never says that. In fact, it seems to say quite the opposite in Genesis, that now they are able to understand both good and evil. So humanity hasn't lost their capacity to understand good and evil. They were still born with a conscience, as Romans chapter 2 indicates. We still have the ability to judge what is right and what is wrong, and to make choices, therefore. Does not mean that if you make the right choice occasionally that you've earned your salvation, or that you can merit God's favor by making a right choice here or a right choice there. That's never what we're trying to argue. We're just simply saying that because mankind has the moral capacity to judge between what's right and what's wrong, that's what makes them responsible. That cannot, however, earn or merit their salvation. Even their good actions, even their right choices, are as filthy rags in the sight of God. Apart from God's work in atoning through Jesus Christ, the shedding of blood, there would be no forgiveness of sins. And therefore, all the right actions, even if somebody's as good as Mother Teresa their entire life, that's not enough to merit their salvation. Or even when an infant, for example, tragically dies in an accident or is aborted even before they're born, they're not earning or meriting their own salvation by their own righteousness. God's grace covers them. God chooses to pass over, in a sense, their sin. He's not holding them morally accountable for that. And the grace of God through the atoning work of Christ covers it. It covers that curse. It takes care of that. So the confession explains it this way. In the Baptist Faith and Message, it says, through the temptation of Satan, man transgressed the command of God and fell from his original innocence, whereby his posterity inherit a nature, that's the curse, and the environment inclined towards sin. Therefore, as soon as they are capable of moral action, they become transgressors and are under condemnation. Now notice that that's talking about, in a lot of ways, the age of accountability. Notice it says, as soon as they are capable of moral action. That's an age of accountability, which I have an article on at Sociology 101 with a lot of biblical support that goes through Old and New Testament passages supporting the concept of the age of accountability. A lot of people misunderstand the doctrine of the age of accountability, thinking that mankind is somehow saved by his own innocence if he were to perish. And we've already debunked that concept. You're still under the curse of sin. You're still lost in need of a Savior, even if you haven't reached the age of accountability. If someone's mentally deficient, or like I said, an infant, and they're not morally capable of making those decisions or to give an account for themselves, then God can choose in his graciousness to cover them by the blood of Jesus. And we believe that he does so. And so therefore, as soon as they are morally capable of actions, they can become a transgressor because of that inclination, because of the environment that's going to lead them to sin and to be under that condemnation. So only the grace of God, it goes on to say, can bring men into his holy fellowship and enable man to fulfill the creative purpose of God. The sacredness of human personality is evident in that God created man in his own image, and in that Christ died for man. Therefore, every person of every race possesses full dignity and is worthy of respect and Christian love. Again, I encourage you to look at those passages, but notice it says every person is valued in the eyes of God. No one's hated before the creation of the world for no apparent reason, unconditionally rejected by their maker. Everybody is created with value and with purpose. And though they're fallen, they're still loved. Though they've taken the bite of the apple and have left the garden, the Creator still loves His creation. Though they have taken their inheritance and gone and squandered their wealth, as in the story of the prodigal son, the Father still longs for His creation, His child. He still wants him to be reconciled with Him. And that's the nature of fallen man. They are lost. They are under the curse of sin. They are doomed to destruction without the working of God. But they're also still able to humble themselves, able to see, hear, understand, and repent in light of God's revelation, God's truth, brought by His gracious Holy Spirit wrought gospel and the holy apostles. He's able to respond to God's truth. This is not just about the nature of man. Please understand this. It's also about the nature of God's word. If people try to make it just about the nature of man, they're not getting the full picture, because we have to discuss not only the nature of man, you also have to discuss the nature of God's word. Is God's word sufficient to accomplish the purpose for which God says it was sent? Well, what was God's word sent for? What's the purpose of God's word? According to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, Christ is in us, making His appeal to be reconciled to God. That's the gospel. That's the purpose of the gospel, to make an appeal for all to be reconciled to God. We know from John 20, 31, that He says these things were written, speaking of the gospel, so that you may believe, and that by believing you may have life in His name. So clearly the purpose of the gospel is so that the world may know and believe that He is the Christ, the Son of the living God, so that they may have eternal life. Well, we believe the nature of God's word is sufficient to accomplish the biblically stated purpose, and that is to bring an appeal, that is to enable or to grant repentance, to grant those the ability to respond to His truth. And we believe that the Word of God is sufficient to accomplish the purpose for which God sent it. It will not return void. It will accomplish its purpose. What's that purpose? To effectually save a certain pre-select number of people? The Bible never says that. It says it was sent as an appeal to the entire world. And that appeal is so that you may believe, and that by believing you may have life in His name. That's the truth of God's word. So what can happen if someone's in this fallen condition, under the curse of sin, lost and in need of a Savior? They're morally able to humble themselves and repent, as many children do. Many of us have grown up in church. That's my testimony at the age of 7. I grew up in the church, and I confessed at a very early age because of the influence of my parents in a godly home that raised me in the ways that I should go, that I might not depart from it. And therefore, I was under the curse of sin. Yes, I was lost and in need of a Savior, but I was also morally capable to be molded by the teachings of my parents, by the gospel, by the truth of God's word, and I repented. But what if I hadn't? And this is the story of many other people who continually suppressed the truth in unrighteousness and traded in for lies, as goes on to describe in Romans chapter 1, verse 18 and following. Matter of fact, if you back up before verse 18, where that chapter break is oftentimes put there, there's a little subtitle put before verse 18 in Romans chapter 1. If you back up just before that, he talks about how the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, first to the Jew and then to the Gentile, and that those who live by righteous faith, by faith in the truth of God's word, the righteous will live by faith, he says. But then he goes on to contrast that with the wrath being revealed to those who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. So he's contrasting those who do believe with those who don't believe. A lot of people interpret it within their systematic to say that Romans chapter 1 is talking about the fact that every single person has suppressed the truth and unrighteousness, and every single person has rejected God. But that's not the contrast of Romans chapter 1. He's contrasting those who have lived through faith and the righteousness against those who suppress the truth and will not believe it, and that how they are under God's wrath and they are without excuse because they don't live by faith, because they have refused to believe the truth of God. And so Romans 1's often misapplied because they start at verse 18 instead of backing up really starting at verse 15 and 16, where they should be talking, because Paul is contrasting those who live by faith and the righteousness of God through faith versus those who suppress the truth and unrighteousness. And so what we have here in the second condition of the fallenness of man, we have the hardness of man. Now, there's a self-hardening that takes place. These are those, again, that continually suppress the truth. They grow defiled in their thinking. They grow calloused. We see this in Acts 28, where it talks about in verse 23 and following, where Paul is striving to persuade them all day long, and many were convinced, but some would not believe. And then he goes on to declare a curse from the Old Testament, saying, "You're just like your fathers before them, resisting the Holy Spirit," as he said in Acts 7:51. And he goes on to say of these Israelites that he's speaking to, "Your hearts have become calloused. Otherwise, you might see, hear, turn, and understand. Therefore, I take the message to the Gentiles, and they will listen." There's a contrast there between the Jew and the Gentile. Both of them are sinful. Both of them are fallen. Both of them are under the curse of sin. Both of them are lost in need of a Savior. So what's the contrast that Paul is drawing out between the Jew and the Gentile in this chapter? He's simply saying that the Israelites, being given the revelation of God for all these generations, have grown calloused to that revelation. They've grown hardened. And therefore, they're unable to see, they're unable to hear, they're unable to turn and understand. They've continually suppressed the truth. They've traded it in for lies. They've grown defiled in their thinking. They've grown calloused. Their consciences have become seared. They're not born with their consciences already seared. They're not born with their hearts and their minds already defiled and completely hardened and calloused to the things of God. It has grown that way. Callousing means to strengthen. I've got a calloused here by my ring where it's continually grown calloused over and over and over of rubbing up against that ring. That's a hardening, a strengthening. The heart can become calloused. It can become hardened. And therefore, when you become hardened and you become calloused, it becomes very difficult to see, very difficult to hear, very difficult to understand and repent. Many missionaries understand this, because if you go to a place where the gospel has been heard and rejected over and over and over again, these people's heart is very hard to reach. But when you go to an unreached people group area where the gospel has never been before, oftentimes the field is ripe for harvest, and people's heart is very open to listening and to hearing the truth of the gospel because they have not grown calloused and hardened to it. And so it becomes morally difficult. We see this in other instances, not only age for a young person and an old person, but you also see this contrast with a rich person and someone who's not as rich. How he talks about how sometimes it's difficult for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Why? Well, because wealth, just like the hardening of a heart, the wealth can get in the way. You can think that you're self-sufficient. You can get this picture that I have self-worth and that I can make it on my own, that I can purchase my own friends and I can purchase my own way, and that I've kind of deserve salvation because of look at all that I have and all that I own. And so just as a wealthy person can think that they don't need any help because of their wealth, so too a religious person, the hardened person, the self-righteous Jew of that day especially, could think, "I don't need a physician. I don't need a doctor. I don't need a savior. I don't need any help. I'm taking care of myself. I'm just fine." And it makes it very morally difficult for this person to see, hear, understand, and repent. Is it impossible? No, I think a self-hardened person can be broken. I think sometimes trials and circumstances will break that hardened condition, sometimes losing all of their wealth and getting to the bottom of their barrel, sometimes getting out into that pigsty finally in their life will eventually break that will and break that hardened heart. But they are self-hardened in their rebellion. The Bible talks about this. You can see this in Baker's Evangelical Dictionary of Biblical Theology. It says this: hardening, or the hardness of the heart, is described this way: self-hardening of the heart goes beyond the tragic obtuseness of our inherited condition in the fall of man. Working on the fertile soil of our innately immoral hearts, the act of sinning hardens the heart into a stubborn rebellion against all that is good. So people may harden their own hearts in sinful rebellion and in bitterness or in sheer self-will. And you see the passages listed there of examples of self-hardening, of people who can grow calloused or grow hardened to the things of God through their acts of sinful rebellion. All of us are subject to become hardened by our own self-rebellion. Hebrews chapter 3 warns us, don't allow, when you hear his voice, don't allow your heart to grow hardened like the Israelites did in the wilderness. He warns us again and again, do not allow your hearts to grow calloused or hearts to grow hardened. That's what Hebrews 11 is really all about, warning the Gentiles, don't allow yourself to go down the same path that the Jews did, because if he cut them off in their rebellion, then he'll cut you off as well. So don't become prideful. Don't become callous. Don't become hardened when you hear the voice of God. That's something that any one of us can become, therefore making it morally difficult, very morally difficult for us to see, for us to hear, for us to understand the truth of God. Now, there's another condition that can come upon man, according to the scriptures, and that is the condition of becoming judicially hardened. Now, what's that? Well, judicial is an act of a judge. And a judge, God being a judge, obviously, can choose to cut someone off or to give someone over to their natural condition, to their own desires, to their own hardened will. This would be somewhat equivalent to what we see in 1 Corinthians, where Paul is faced with this unrepentant sinner in the Corinthian church, and he warns them. He says, cut them off. Cast them out of the fellowship, warn them once, warn them twice, and then have nothing to do with them anymore, so that you may save their soul. In other words, the purpose of judicially hardening or cutting somebody off in their rebellion is hopefully to help save their soul, to help them see the error of their ways, not to enable them in their sin to continue sinning, but to cut them off and say, I'm not going to continue to support you. Almost like a parent of a 20-year-old that's living in the basement and become abusive and maybe alcoholic or something of that nature. And the parents, the most loving thing they might be able to do is to say, no longer am I going to support you. No longer we're paying your bills. You're out on your own. And kind of casting them out as that prodigal son, in a sense, say, take your inheritance, go. We're not going to help you anymore. Almost the same thing is happening in a lot of the same ways with God and Israel, is that God's cutting them off. He's judicially, as a judge or as a parent, someone who still loves them, somebody still wants to see them be reconciled, somebody who hates the sin that they've done, someone who's holding out his hands to them all day long, longing to gather them like a mother hen gathering the chicks. He is cutting them off, not out of hatred, not because he doesn't want them, but out of love. He's cutting them off. And so these people are cut off in unbelief, as Romans 11, 20 says. They're not cut off for no apparent reason before the foundation of the world. They're not cut off because God just wants to demonstrate his power and show how powerful good he is in reprobating them. No, they're cut off for their unbelief. So there's a reason for them to be cut off. It's not unconditional being reprobated or being cut off. They're cut off because they have chosen freely not to believe. They have chosen freely to trade the truth in for lies. They have chosen freely in their rebellion. So they've become callous, not because God didn't love them, not because God didn't want them, but because of their own resistance and their own rebellion against the truth of God. And so these are people who are spoken to only in parables, for example. These are people who God only reveals himself to in ways that they can't really understand who he is and truly begin to see him, because he wants to accomplish a purpose through them. And so these are people who have become morally unable to see, to hear, to understand, and to repent. He speaks to them in riddles. Let's look at that. See it here in Mark chapter 4, beginning in verse 10, when he was alone with the 12 and the others around him asked about the riddles or the parables. He told them, well, the secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to those on the outside, everything is said in parables, so that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving, ever hearing but never understanding. Otherwise, they might turn and be forgiven. Who is he talking about? He's talking about the Israelite leaders of that day. That he is speaking to them in parables because they are seeing it, but they're not perceiving it. He's using what some scholars refer to as the messianic secret, where he's saying, don't show these people. I'm not going to show these people who I really am. I'm not going to reveal to them my identity, because they're calloused and they're hardened in their self-righteousness, and they're not going to understand and accept these things in the way that they need to be understood and accepted anyway. So I'm not going to reveal these things to them, and I don't want them to turn and be forgiven. It even says to be forgiven here. So this is not talking about a false conversion. He's actually expecting that they could turn and be forgiven, but he's not wanting them to do that yet. And so he goes on to explain this parable to his own followers, his apostles, but he's hiding it from the wise and the learned of that day, the leaders of the Pharisees of that day, and he's revealing it to babes, to blue-collar fishermen, to people like Peter, to no names. And he's hiding it from the wise and learned. Now, what would be the use in hiding something from somebody who's already born corpse-like dead and totally, completely incapable of believing and understanding God? There wouldn't be a reason for that. It's like putting a blindfold on a corpse. The reason Jesus is using parables is as a strategy to make sure that he accomplishes redemption. It's as 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 and following talks about, that these things have been hidden for generations. And had they known who the Messiah was, they would never have crucified the Lord of glory. And so in order to accomplish redemption through Calvary, in order to engraft the Gentiles, Jesus uses riddles, he uses parables to judicially harden, to keep them in their blindness, to send them a spirit of stupor, if you will. And you'll notice here, if you go down to verse 34, he goes on to explain the parables. He gives a clear explanation to his own apostles. But there in verse 33, actually, it says, "With many similar parables or riddles, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable." Did you notice that? He did not say anything to them without using a riddle. "But when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything." Do you see the importance of that? He's not trying to show his truth of his identity to every single person while he's down from heaven. He's only choosing to reveal himself to a select few, and to the rest, he is judicially hardening. He is giving them over to their own natural decisions and their desires. He is cutting them off, and therefore, during this time, they are morally unable, depraved in an inability to come to and recognize Jesus as their Messiah. They are cut off from the revelation of God for this time. Now, Paul still holds out hope for these same people. These same people who are hardened are the same ones that he hopes to provoke to envy by his message to the Gentiles, as Romans chapter 11, verse 14 says. He even goes on to say that if they leave their unbelief, they will be grafted back in. He says that they have stumbled in chapter 9 of Romans, but in chapter 11, he says they have stumbled, but not beyond recovery. In other words, these are not people that are hopeless and helpless. These are people who, yes, have become self-hardened in their rebellion. They have continually suppressed the truth to trade it in for lies, but they have hope. Paul holds out hope for them, and so do we. We believe that those who've become self-hardened can be, even if they're used by God to bring about a redemptive purpose, they can be provoked by envy. They can be provoked. Their wills can be provoked, that God can still save them. And we pray that God does. You see, Romans 9, 10, and 11 is about the expanding of God's love and mercy, not about the narrowing of it. It's about God bringing mercy to all people, as verse 32 of chapter 11 says, that he has bound all men over to disobedience. Why? So that he may have mercy on them all. This is about expanding of God's love and his goodness. The Bible actually speaks of this in several chapters and several verses. Baker's Evangelical Dictionary of the Biblical Theology says this: judicial hardening in a few instances, such as Pharaoh and the Egyptians, those are the verses there, Shihon, the king of Heshbon, Deuteronomy 2:30, and the Hivites, according to Gibbon, John 11, 19 and 20, it is said that God hardened their hearts. Apparently, these people were so irremediably in their rebellion against God, and God entered into the hardening process so that he could accomplish his purpose in spite of, and yet in and through that hardness. It is God's prerogative as God to do this, as Romans 9, 18 through 21 says. That they are morally responsible for their condition is a theological given, and we are warned not to harden our hearts as they did, a command that would make no sense if hardening were simply God's act, 1 Samuel 6:6. Israel's hardening as a nation was an act of self-hardening, followed by God's act of judicial hardening as clearly portrayed in the scriptures we see in Matthew 23:37, Romans 10 and 11 as well. I want you to understand this because many people theologically have taken the condition of the judicially hardened Jew, one who has grown self-hardened by his own free choices and thus been cut off in his unbelief, and given over to his rebellion, sent a spirit of stupor, spoken to in parables. They have taken that unique circumstance and situation within the New Testament, and they have applied it to their soteriological worldview in the nature of man. And they've described mankind not as being born within God's image and able to choose between right and wrong, be able to choose whether to accept or to reject his truth, but instead what they've said, that all mankind is born in this already judicially hardened condition, as in all practical purposes. They may not use that vocabulary to say literally that they are already born judicially hardened, but for all practical purposes, they might as well, because they're exactly the same. The fallen man within the Calvinistic worldview especially is already judicially hardened in the sense that he's born unable to see, unable to hear, unable to turn and to repent. That is not a biblical concept. The Bible doesn't say that. Yes, the Bible says they're born sinful. Yes, the Bible says they're born enemies of God. Yes, the Bible says all of these kinds of things about the fallenness of man. The Bible never says, however, that man is incapable of responding positively to the light of God's truth and his revelation brought by the Holy Spirit. It simply never does. That's something that the Calvinistic system has imposed upon the text. It is never supported anywhere. Yes, they have proof texts to try to support it, but I challenge you to look at those proof texts with these things in mind, to understand whether the Scripture is actually talking about the natural condition of man from birth as decreed by God, or whether it may be talking about the judicially hardened nature of the Israelites of the New Testament, those who have been given over, those who have grown calloused and hardened in their self-righteousness, and that God is using for a redemptive plan and redemptive purpose in his sovereign will to bring about the crucifixion and thus the redemption of all people. Please consider this. This, I think, is really the crux of the debate between Calvinism and those of us who deny Calvinism. And whenever we really begin to understand the nature of man and how God has created humanity, then we can truly understand that God is not the cause or the author of sin in any way, shape, or form, that he is not the one who has, quote-unquote, brought about all evil for his own glorification, but that instead, as the free will theodicy is argued, that God has created man with free moral will. Therefore, he has decreed not which choices that we'll make, but that we'll be free to make them. And therefore, every choice that we make that is evil and against God's will actually is something that God can turn and redeem and use for good, but it is not something that he caused or purposed or brought to pass by his sovereign decree or will. God does not desire for men to do evil. He does not decree or determine for men to do evil. He allows for mankind to make their own choices and suffer under the full weight of that choice. That's what wrath is. Wrath is the removal of God's protection. Wrath is God backing away and allowing the natural things to happen as a result of our evil choices, which includes the rape and Holocaust and all these horrible things. God does not bring those things to pass to make himself look good, as we hear John Piper and others arguing in their studies. Instead, those things come to pass because of free will, because mankind is free and autonomous and separate from our holy, holy, holy God, who is perfect, who does not even look upon evil, who would never tempt men to sin, as James chapter 1 says. God is not the cause of sin. He is not the cause of evil, and he's certainly not the cause of why people reject him. People are not hating God because God first hated them. People are not rejecting a God who first rejected them for no apparent reason before the creation of the world. Instead, men who grow calloused through suppressing the truth and unrighteousness, through trading the truth in for lies, can grow more and more calloused and more stubborn to the point where finally, at times, they could be given over to that callous condition, cut off from the revelation of the truth of God's light, and even used in their rebellion to bring about a redemptive good by God if he so chooses. He is perfectly sovereign as the potter to do that. He can mold broken lumps of clay and use that broken lump for his noble good like he did with Pharaoh. He can also take that broken lump and remold it and reshape it and use a blinding light or a big fish to convince that otherwise rebellious messenger to go and to take the message where he wants it to go. God's sovereign that way. But we don't believe sovereign means to meticulously control even the evil intentions of man, because that would deny his holiness. I pray that you'll help me spread this word. Help us at Soteriology 101 to make this truth known. God is holy, he is just, and he is good, and he loves all people. Every man, woman, boy, and girl has been paid for. God has provided salvation for everyone. There is no one who dies, who goes to spend eternity separated from God, who could say, I did not have atonement paid for me. I did not have a God who loved me. I did not have a God who sought after me. I did not have a God who provided for me. There is no one who is in hell who is going to be able to say, I was born hated by my Maker, rejected by my King, rejected by my Savior. Instead, those who perish, perish only because they refuse to love the truth so as to be saved. They did not enter the promised land. Why? Because of their unbelief, according to Hebrews chapter 3. There is no other reason. My well-intending Calvinistic friends simply are striving, I think, and they mean well, by trying to give God all the glory for everything that happens, including our decision to humble ourselves and to confess our sins. But in their effort, what they've ultimately done, in my estimation, is they have given God all the blame for every sin that takes place, for every rejection of His calling, for everyone who's hardened and everyone who rejects Him is ultimately put back onto God, our holy, perfect God. And that cannot continue. We must stand and we must teach this truth very clearly so that people do know of God's universal love and provision for all people. Thanks for tuning in. Goodbye.